You are listening to the audio production of A Prairie Devotional, inspired by the beloved TV series by Wendi Lou Lee, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Suzie Althens.
Dedication. In memory of Laura Ingalls Wilder, for the stories she told and her faith in God. Welcome to my little house. My family's favorite gathering place is the hand-me-down couch filled with colorful pillows in our living room, a brimming bookcase along one side, and a white-mantled fireplace on the other. On the top shelf of the corner hutch sits a framed photo of my twin sister, Brenda, and me. We are snuggled on Michael Landon's lap. Pa is playfully grinning as though he's the luckiest man on earth. Whenever I look at that photo, I grin too. At 8 months old, Brenda and I were cast as baby Grace, Charles Ingalls' youngest daughter, for the television series Little House on the Prairie. The 4 seasons we spent as baby Grace turned our lives right side up. Although too young to grasp our good fortune, we have since come to realize that we are, the lucky ones, blessed to have been part of a television family that modeled for us what a real family can be. I don't know if your parents watched Little House with you the way mine did, but it was a tradition I carried on when I became a parent. When my daughter began kindergarten, the Ingalls family entertained us every Monday night. With each episode, I gleaned nuggets of wisdom from Charles and Carolyn, and even from the unlikely character of Nellie Olson. Many of the relationship and faith connections I had missed when watching as a child now jumped out at me as an adult. I saw relevant lessons for today, and the episodes became opportunities for family discussions. One night, as all of us crowded onto the couch watching a favorite Little House episode, my husband suggested that I write a devotional built on the show's themes. Although it sounded like a great idea, I didn't have the confidence to try. Growing up in a broken home and being the younger twin, I struggled with self-doubt. A devotional sounded like a task too great for me to attempt. Years of joy and heartbreak went by, both for our family and for the Ingallses. As we watched the Ingalls family overcome challenges week after week, I noticed how universal and timeless the themes were. We all struggle with loneliness, illness, setbacks, and loss. I had been diagnosed with a brain tumor and was dealing with insecurity, grief, and the unknowns of brain surgery. My family's challenges were no different from those of the Ingalls family. Just as Little House encouraged us, I could encourage others. If I paid heed to Pa, that is. All you can do is try, he'd said. This devotional is the result of doing just that. First airing in 1974 and running for 9 seasons, the television series was based on Laura Ingalls Wilder's children's books. Wilder charmed the world with her delightful stories of growing up as a pioneer girl. Although her stories are not all happy, they do encourage and inspire. Underlying her adventures is a strong faith in a good God, faith to which the television series stayed true. Within this book are stories of joy and heartache, fear and triumph, doubt and strength, each story a testament of faith that helped the Ingalls family, and our family, navigate life's challenges. I invite you to gather your family on your couch and join me as we step into the world of the Ingallses and into a closer walk with God. Wendi Lou Lee. Season 6, Episode 11, Author. Devotional 1. Become a Storyteller. You better get some more paper, then. Your grandpa's got a whole lifetime of stories in his head. Carolyn Ingalls. How we live our lives determines what kind of story we can tell. Every day we choose to dive deep into life or watch it pass by. We can live an epic life without visiting exotic places or having extravagant experiences. We just need to engage in the epicness of our own backyards and anywhere our feet might tread. When we live with this attitude, stories emerge, stories we can't help but share. When Carolyn's mother passes away, her grieving father loses the will to live. He resolves to wait passively and watch his life end, until Albert asks about his childhood. A story erupts from his brittle soul, and he becomes a passionate storyteller of his past. Like Grandpa Holbrook, my grandmother lost her spouse after 47 years of marriage. Grandma Lou was a storyteller when we were growing up. I remember the famous childhood tale of life on her family farm in Minnesota, hunting down a chicken with an axe, and then her expression when she told us how the headless chicken chased her around the barnyard. She said killing Sunday dinner was the worst of all chores. I must have heard that story 100 times. After my grandfather died, Grandma Lou kept right on living. Her adventures and memories only became more epic, not because the experiences were grand, but because every day captivated her. Every visit became a spillway of new stories, moments when she chose to fully live. The opportunities she embraced were transformed into more exciting encounters to share with us. I encourage you to experience and share the extraordinary life God's given you. What kind of story are you living? Is it a life worth retelling? Take the plunge. Don't spectate. Participate. And then share what happens. When Grandpa Holbrook started telling stories, he was inspired to keep living. Writing his memoir gave him a bounce in his step and a sparkle in his eyes. All it took was one story to breathe new life into him. Live your life in a way that your stories will be told 100 times over. Tell your children about it in the years to come, and let your children tell their children. Pass the story down from generation to generation. Joel, chapter 1, verse 3. Are you more likely to experience the day and see it as an adventure, or sit and watch from the sidelines? How can you engage in the opportunities God puts in front of you? Season 3, Episode 10, The Hunters. Devotional 2. Fateful Lunch Date. Things are meant to be. Sam Shelby. I believe God has a plan, an intention from the beginning. He puts us in exactly the right places at the right times to accomplish His will. God used Sam Shelby, a blind man, to save Charles on a hunting trip. Sam had given up on being useful until Laura came running for help. Helping was his destiny. My role as baby Grace was God's idea. My sister and I weren't infants pursuing a career, and my mother never dreamed of being an acting manager. It happened by the grace of God. My grandmother was a friend of Sue McCrae, the casting director for Little House on the Prairie. They were chatting over lunch when Sue revealed that she couldn't find twins to portray Charles Ingalls' youngest daughter. We were exactly the right age. We had the towhead blonde hair and blue eyes they were looking for. Some people may call it coincidence or a lucky draw, but I believe God orchestrated the whole scene. The Lord used the blind Sam Shelby to help Charles, and He arranged baby Grace's fateful lunch date. God is always working out the plan He formed in the beginning, always purposefully unfolding what's meant to be, in your life and in mine. Before I shaped you in the womb, I knew all about you. Before you saw the light of day, I had holy plans for you. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5. Do you believe God carefully plans all the details of our lives? When have you seen a glimpse of His plan for you? Season 1, Episode 2, Country Girls. Devotional 3. Nasty Nellies. Country Girls. Nellie Olson. Nasty Nellies always seem to appear when we are especially insecure and our courage is less than lion-like. Nellie Olson's words weren't untrue on the Ingalls' first day of school, but the way she said them snatched away Laura's courage. First days of school are uncomfortable enough without a nasty Nellie running around, stripping people of much-needed confidence. My first day of high school mirrored Laura's. We both felt uncertain of ourselves. As I walked to school, I was terrified. My twin sister and a new girl, who had just moved to town, were beside me. Agreeing where to meet for lunch, we rushed to class as the first bell rang. 4 hours later, we searched for a place to eat far from the cafeteria and my old group of friends. A spiritual change that summer left me unsure of how to act around them. Instead of being brave and sharing my new faith, I was hiding out. We settled on a grassy patch and ate our lunches. The sun shone bright, and I finally began to relax. As I balled up my empty lunch sack, a girl came running over. She had blonde hair and a loud and rude demeanor. So like Nellie. She looked at us in disgust and sneered, "Freshman." I'll never forget the look on her face. It wasn't what she said, but the way she said it made our hearts sink. She might as well have been wearing a big bow on top of her head, one that matched her outfit, just like Nellie. It's been almost 25 years since then, and I am finally learning to be bold. I'm not as concerned about what others think. My lifetime of stories about God are pouring out of me. When a nasty Nellie tries to discourage you, remember Laura. Don't stick out your tongue the way Laura did, but know in your heart that your experiences are more powerful than mean words. You may not think bravery is in your bones, but God will give you the strength to be courageous when you trust Him. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Joshua chapter 1, verse 9. Have you ever encountered a nasty Nellie? How do hurtful people drain your courage? What can you do to ignite courage in yourself and in someone else? Season 2, Episode 13, The Talking Machine. Devotional 4, Declarations of Love. Nothing bad comes from telling people how you feel. Charles Ingalls. Expressing our feelings can be scary. We often hide our emotions to protect ourselves. Laura is crushed when her feelings for a boy are recorded on a talking machine and then played for the entire school. Charles tries to make her feel better and says it's good to share her feelings with others. He says people want to know they are loved, needed, and cared for. It takes courage to tell someone what's happening inside us. The telling is never a wrong choice, even if it doesn't always end the way we hope. I wanted to say those three little words. Wanted to tell Josh how I felt my whole world belonged by his side. But I was scared he'd look back at me with an empty expression and smile awkwardly. When I finally found the courage to speak, I found out he'd been waiting all along for me to say, "I love you," before he did. My courage sparked his. My husband is a quiet guy. He talks a bit more than our goldfish. It's not that he doesn't have anything to say, but he weighs his words. He's careful with what comes out of his mouth. Not me. I throw words around like a pizza chef throws dough. It can be quite a mess sometimes. And then again, words spoken from the heart can start something wonderful. God's declarations of love are all around us. He expresses His love through nature and people, and mostly through His word. And while not all love stories are dependable, His is. God demonstrated His love through Jesus. He made the first move, proclaiming the words of love by sending His Son to die, all so we could know Him. Charles advises Laura not to hide her feelings, even if she is embarrassed and doesn't know how the boy will respond. Telling God how we feel is a completely different experience. We don't have to wait for the right timing or the perfect words. We can fling adoration and praise all over the place. He delights in hearing how much we love Him. In the end, the boy, Jason, openly confesses his love to Laura in front of the entire class. It's a bold declaration, but not nearly as bold as God's love for us. This is real love. Not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. Dear friends, since God loved us that much, we surely ought to love each other. 1 John chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. Are you often afraid to share your feelings? You can ask God to make you brave enough to talk about your feelings when you need to. Season 1, Episode 17, Doctor's Lady. Devotional 5. Flying High. For the first time in my life, I feel alive. Doc Baker. Love has a way of igniting new life in us. It makes us smile so big that our cheeks hurt, and the joy inside feels as if it might burst out through our skin. It's as if we're flying among the clouds. Walnut Grove's Dr. Baker had this experience when he met Kate. She was young and full of life. He didn't know what she saw in him, but she loved him, and that gave Dr. Baker a feeling he'd never experienced. A few years ago, I felt the same way when I opened my eyes after brain surgery. I emerged from that experience with a new story of God's abundant faithfulness and goodness. Energy bubbled out of me that a 7-year-old boy couldn't match. Boisterous, animated words tumbled out of my mouth, dripping with hope. And even as the painkillers wore off, the joy did not fade. I knew after surviving this surgery that God had given me a story of his outrageous love, a story I can't help but share. It's too glorious not to. I believe Jesus wants us to live with an excitement for life, the way Doc Baker was changed because of his love for Kate. Years of loneliness often precede heart-awakening love. Health challenges are sometimes the stepping stones to unfathomable renewal. If you're in a difficult situation, keep seeking God through his word. He will strengthen you. And if you are flying in the clouds, thank God every day and tell someone how you got there. A thief has only one thing in mind. He wants to steal, slaughter, and destroy. But I have come to give you everything in abundance, more than you expect. Life in its fullness until you overflow. John chapter 10, verse 10. Think of a time when you felt a new excitement for life. What sparked the change? How can you take a step toward feeling alive today? Season 5, Episode 8, Harriet's Happenings. Devotional 6, Not a Magic Cure. I'm afraid that's too little too late, Mrs. Olson. The harm's already been done. Carolyn Ingalls. Apologies don't erase what's been said or done. They may help soothe hurt feelings or clarify the real intention. But saying, I'm sorry, isn't a magic cure for relationship or emotional damage. It's not that easy. Harriet Olson has been slandering the people of Walnut Grove in the town newspaper. Carolyn confronts her about the gossip and rumors, but an apology can't repair the destruction she's caused. Hurtful words aren't always malicious, but apologies don't solve the problem every time. I was engaged my last semester of college. It seemed every friend bought me a bridal magazine. I had already purchased my wedding dress, so I'm not sure why Modern Bride's Best Dresses of 1999 was on our coffee table. One day, flipping through the pages, I asked my fiancé if he liked a certain dress. When it comes to fashion or decorating, my husband is super opinionated. The thing is, he usually doesn't say anything unless I ask for his impression. I don't know what I thought to gain through this silly interaction, but it didn't go well. I understand now that I was setting him up for inevitable failure. It's all right. I guess I'm not crazy about spaghetti straps. I suspect my face went blank because my wedding dress had spaghetti straps. I got
real quiet. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.